friends, good afternoon and welcome to EduSat Live Lectures. Dear friends, today in World Geography Through Map, we will be learning about North America. To discuss this topic, we have with us our subject expert, Dr. B.W. Pandey. Dr. Pandey is Associate Professor in Department of Geography in Delhi School of Economics, University of Delhi. Without further ado, I would like to welcome sir to our studios and request him to start the lecture. Welcome, sir.
Thank you, Amit. Good afternoon, friends. In the series of the world map, I am going to discuss today is part third, North America continent. And we'll go through detail about the North America physical map, North America political map, we'll discuss economic map, then socio-cultural demographic features, and finally we'll discuss about some international parameters, global parameters for North America continent. Friends, this is very much interesting to learn about North America continent, which is at present time leading the world. Its economic prosperity, strategic development and influence at the global scale. And you will see how the people of North America, they have made their resources highly developed. No doubt, it is a continent which is having plenty of land. Also, in the east and the west, having two very important oceanic features like Atlantic Ocean in the east and the Pacific Ocean in the west. And you will see how the people of North America have made such a valuable resources to their use for their development. Friends, first of all, if you see the map of North America continent, I would like to show you its shape. It looks like magic lamp of Aladdin. See, it's quite wide in the north and becomes narrow in the south. And its impact on the geopolitical map, that the country which lies in the north, that is Canada, is the largest country of North America continent. Then south of Canada is USA, the second largest country of North America, and then further south of USA is Mexico, third largest country of North America, and then further south the countries become small because of less geographical area. So the size of the country reduces from north to south. So Canada, then USA, then Mexico, and after that we see the countries of Isthmus. Isthmus is a chain of land which connect two big land masses and divides two large water bodies. You can see in the world map, you can find that this is the two big land masses of North America and South America linked with a small stretch of land. This is called Isthmus. So there are number of countries which lies over Isthmus of North America, though a true Isthmus country is Panama. Panama is a true sense Isthmus country. You'll find Panama, Costa Rica, Nicaragua, Honduras, Salvador, Belize, Guatemala, and finally Mexico. Therefore, this country becomes small because of isthmus effect. And in the north, there are big land mass in the north, so northern countries are larger, so Canada, US, and then Mexico. So, first of all, you will see the political map of North America continent. In the political map, you will see this is the territory of Canada, it is the largest country of North America, and if you see carefully the northern part of Canada, you will find that in the northern part of Canada, there are thousands and thousands of the islands, thousands and thousands of the islands. If you count all the islands and the highly fjord coast of Canada, friends, though Canada is the second largest country after Russia, but being its large number of islands altogether along with the mainland of Canada, Canada having longest coastline in the world, even more than Russia because of these islands. Then from Canada, south of Canada is the USA, then Mexico, and south of Mexico you will find the countries like Guatemala, this is Belize, El Salvador, Honduras, Nicaragua, Costa Rica, and Panama. Friends, our focus will be over the fiscal and political map of North America, and you will see its application, how the physiological map, political map of North America has made the American countries, US and Canada, very rich in the world, powerful in the world, and how judiciously and how properly the people of the North America continent, they have utilized their land to make the country develop economy, develop society. Coming to North America, we talk about sometimes question comes about America. So, when we say America, then I would like to take you the world map. You will see that America as a whole divided into broadly three parts. Number one covers the Anglo-America. Anglo-America includes US and Canada. USA and Canada form the Anglo-America. Then south of USA, beginning from Mexico to Panama, and these island countries of Caribbean Sea, they are called Antilles. These countries altogether known as Central America. Central America, you can see the map. Central America covers the isthmus countries and countries of the Antilles. Antilles are the group of the islands beginning from Cuba. All these islands altogether known as Antilles. Friends, you can see in the northwest, these islands are large size islands. So, they are called as a Greater Antilles. These are greater entities like Cuba, Jamaica, Haiti, Dominican Republic, they are big islands, so called greater entities. And then you find the small islands, very, very small islands, thousands and thousands of small islands, these are called lesser entities because they are a small size, so they are called lesser entities. These all together form Central America, and then south of the Central America or the countries of Latin language. Therefore, South America, also known as Latin America. Hence, the America divided in three parts: Anglo-America, Central America, and Latin America. Today, we will discuss Anglo-America, major part of North America continent. Now, see the physical map of North America continent, and you analyze that the eastern part of North America, including both US and Canada, eastern part of North America having very old land mass, very old land surface, and I'd like to show you this is 100 degree west meridian, this line called 100 degree west meridian. This is a geological divide of North America. This line is 100 degree west meridian. So, in the east of the 100 degree west meridian, these land masses of US and Canada are very, very old. These are Paleozoic rocks having plateaus and plains. These geological structure are very, very rich in metallic minerals and fossil minerals. Therefore, east of the 100 degree meridian, there are large number of iron ore mine, coal mine, the uranium mine, the copper mine, the bauxite mine, and many other mineral resources. While in the west of the 100 degree meridian, these are tertiary rocks, and these are alpine mountains. In the west, right from Alaska to the Mexico, all these are alpine mountains, young fold mountains, new land. Therefore, metallic minerals are very rare in the west, and its application you can find when we discuss the economic map of North America, US and Canada. You will find that because of this geological effect, most of the iron and steel industries are located between the Great Lakes and Appalachian Mountains. Between Appalachian and Great Lakes, covering both the Canada and US, having most of its heavy industries, major iron ore mines, iron steel industries, and the sequential automobile industries and other heavy industries, consumer industries. And this is the reason that there is a industrial inertia, early development of the industries took place in the eastern part of North America continent. Friends, this is the reason that eastern part of Canada, eastern part of USA, very densely populated because the density of industries are high, heavy industries are there. So, there is more massive large scale urbanization. So, 100 degree west meridian also it divides the physiological characteristics of North America. Very clearly it is obvious from the map that 100 degree west meridian divides plains in the east. This is the Great Plains of US, the Great Plains of Canada. East of the 100 degree west meridian are the plains, river plains, and in the west of the 100 degree meridian, these are all mountains, high relief, undulated land. So, in the east of 100 degree meridian, you find the gentle slope, plain areas, and also 100 degree west meridian, popularly known as coal line. Coal line because almost 100% anthracite bituminous good quality of coal of North America found in the east of the 100 degree meridian. In the west of the 100 degree meridian, they find lignite coal, maybe some petroleum in the west coast and some fault valleys like Sacramento, San Joaquin Valley. But most of the good quality of coal reserves found in the east of 100 degree west meridian. So, broadly you can see the western part having young fold mountains and eastern part having plain and plateaus. Eastern part having old mountains, primary period mountains, which have lost their peaks and have been converted as a plateau. Friends, first of all, I would like to show the mountains, then we'll come to the plateau. So, mountains right throughout the west coast of North America, there are chain of mountains beginning from Alaska. Alaska having three mountain ranges, Brooks Range in the north, Brooks Range and Alaska Range in the south, and Alaska Range, this is the highest range of North America continent, Mount McKinley, 6194 meter. Mount McKinley is the highest peak of North America continent. Then you find Kuskokwim Mountain in the center, and further south Alaska Range. So, Brooks Range, Kuskokwim and Alaska Range. Then in the south, coming to the Canada, there is extension of the mountain which develops quite large size and become parallel. So, you form Mackenzie Mountain, Rocky Mountain and Coast Range, coastal mountains. Rocky Mountain passing through Canada, it enters in US and divides in three large parallel ranges. These ranges form Bighorn, Bitterroot and Levi's. Bighorn, Bitterroot and Levi's. Friends, these three parallel mountain ranges I would like to show you. This is Bitterroot and Bighorn, Bitterroot, Levi's Mountain. All together, these three ranges form the largest cordillera in the world. This is Bighorn, Bighorn Mountain, Bitterroot and Levi's Mountain. These three mountains form parallel and the largest cordillera in the world. Three cordilleras are globally known. First is the Rocky Mountain Cordillera, which includes Bighorn, Bitterroot and Levi's range. Second cordillera formed the northern part of Andes Mountain in South America, which is known as Western Cordillera, Central Cordillera and Eastern Cordillera. This is known as Occidental, Central and Oriental. And the third cordillera in the world formed in the Central Asia, the Himalayan Cordillera, which covered the Himadri, Himachal and Shivalik Mountains. That is popularly known as Greater Himalaya, Lesser Himalaya and foothills of Shivaliks. Then there are, apart from these fold mountains, there are a number of fault valleys which have developed, and parallel to the fault valleys there are a number of coastal mountains, fault mountains, and this is from Sierra Nevada. Friends, Sierra Nevada is the largest, Sierra Nevada is the longest fault mountain in the world. And because of the origin of the fault, so one piece of the land moves up from the mountain and the vicinity, the next part moves down and form the fault. So parallel to Sierra Nevada, there are Sacramento and San Joaquin Valley. This is the longest fault valley of North America continent and in USA, in California. So river draining in the fault line from the north is Sacramento and from the south is San Joaquin. So this is popularly known as Sacramento San Joaquin Valley. I will discuss its economic importance later on. So the Sierra Nevada Mountain, Coast Mountain, Cascade Mountain, the Coast Range, Alaska Range, these form the coastal areas of North America. While in the east, eastern part, the old mountain which is eroded away, known as Appalachian Mountain. Appalachian, as such, there is no any range which is called Appalachian. Appalachians are the name of the group of the old eroded mountains. The Relict Mountain, which are very old Paleozoic mountains and largely affected by erosion. So that covers the Cumberland, Allegheny, Blue Ridge, Six Sack, the all the way extending to the Notre Dame Mountain, altogether White Mountain, Blue Mountain, all these mountains altogether known as Appalachian Mountains. Like in India, in the northeastern part of India, there are Purvanchal Mountains. As such, there is no any range called Purvanchal, rather it is the name of all the hills of the northeast south of Brahmaputra known as Purvanchal, like Garo, Khasi, Jayantia, Lusai, Patkei, Mikir, all together. Similarly, the Cumberland, Blue Ridge, Allegheny, Six Sack, the Notre Dame, all together, these hills known as Appalachian Mountain. Among the Appalachian Blue Ridge is the highest, where Mount Mitchell is the highest peak of Appalachian. Mount Mitchell is the highest point of the eastern US, eastern North America. Friends, apart from this, mountains and hills, the another important feature of North America continents are lakes. These lakes are various types, and these lakes formed by glacier, so called glacial lakes. Friends, largest number and largest area of the glacial lakes in the world lies in North America continent. If you see the map, all the way from north to the southeast, from northwest to southeast, more than 10,000 lakes, more than 10,000 lakes formed due to glacier. So, Canada, the land of lakes, land of 10,000 lakes. Similarly, in Europe, the northwestern part of Europe have also the lakes formed by glacier. Finland, called as land of 1,000 lakes. So, Canada, land of 10,000 lakes. Among the major lakes, I'd like to mention, this is the Great Bear Lakes, Great Slave Lakes, there is Athabasca Lake, Winnipeg Lakes, Reindeer Lakes and Winnipeg Lakes. These are all Canada, and then Great Lakes. Friends, Great Lakes form the Lake Superior, Lake Michigan, Lake Huron, Lake Erie and the Lake Ontario. This bunch of the five lakes called Finger Lakes, like five fingers in the hand, the five lakes, the Finger Lakes called Great Lakes. And between the Lake Erie and the Lake Ontario, there is the widest waterfall in the world. This is called Niagara Waterfall. Friends, out of the five lakes, four lakes form international boundary between US and Canada. So, Lake Superior, Lake Huron, Lake Erie and Lake Ontario divides the international boundary between US and Canada. Lake Michigan lies in USA only, and Niagara Falls also makes international boundary. So, one bank of Niagara is US, other bank of Niagara is Canada. These lakes play very, very important role in the climatic conditions of North America. You know, when the polar air mass moves south in winter season, there is thermodynamic effect of these lakes, that CP, continental polar air mass, become humid, and due to lake effect, it yields very, very heavy snowfall in the northeastern part of US and Canada. Friends, that is called lake effect snowfall. So, it is very big impact on climate. Also, because of these lakes provide an ideal condition for industrial development through the inland navigation. And let me tell you that this is not only inland navigation, rather all these lakes are interlinked through the canals. For example, Lake Superior, Lake Huron linked with Sioux Canal. Sioux Canal connects Lake Superior to Lake Huron. Mackinac Canal connects Lake Michigan to Lake Huron, Mackinac Canal. Then Lake Huron to Lake Erie, Detroit Canal, and Lake Erie to Lake Ontario. To avoid the aesthetics of the Niagara Fall, because Niagara Fall lies between the Erie and Ontario, it is the ultimate source of tourism for both the countries. Therefore, they are not going to destroy the ecological system of Niagara Falls. Therefore, Americans have developed a bypass canal passing through the Hamilton City, connecting Erie and Ontario. So, this is called Hamilton Canal. Friends, we will cover the other questions and answers. If you have any regarding this map, you are most welcome. Thank you so much. Hello friends, welcome to EduSet lecture, and we are going to discuss world geography through map, and we will discuss detail about the economy of North America, mainly focusing over industries, agriculture and trade, North America continent, and mainly we will cover the Anglo-America, US and Canada. The well-developed transportation system, rich mineral resources and highly developed demographic condition, social condition of North America in US and Canada. You will see that it is the impact over economy and society. We will see the important mineral resources. As I have told you, that eastern part of North America having very old land mass, rather I can tell you that the first continent, supercontinent Pangaea, and the later on divided two parts, Gondwana land, Angara land. So those piece of land mass, which was continent at the first continent of the earth, and even today it is continent, that is known as Creton in southern part and known as Sealed in the northern part. Friends, you can find the Canadian Sealed, you can find the Canadian Sealed. This is the Canadian Sealed. This is one of the oldest landmass in the world. It is the oldest landmass of the North America continent as well as Canada. The Canadian Sealed and the eastern part, east of the 100 degree meridian, eastern part of the US and Canada, contain very old rock structure, very old geology, therefore very rich in mineral resources. There are very rich iron ore mine lying between the Great Lakes and Appalachian Mountains. Friends, this region is one of the largest iron ore region of the world. Mesabi, this is the area between Lake Superior and Lake Michigan. This is the area having richest iron ore deposit in the world. Mesabi, Suyuna, Gojebik, Marquette, these are very specific names of the iron ore mines. Mesabi, Suyuna, Gojebik, and Marquette cover the between Superior and Michigan. This is the area very rich in iron ore. Also, iron ore found in the northern part of Appalachian Range. Right from the Appalachian in the northern part, extending between US and Canada. Between US and Canada, there are Sept Isles, the large amount of deposits of iron ore, along with iron ore, Appalachian are also one of the largest deposits of coal in the world, the coal mines. Similarly, having limestones. Therefore, there are series of the iron and steel industries developed in along the lake. So, I would like to mention the name of the few important steel plants. We will find the Chicago, Gary, Chicago and Gary along the coast bank of the Lake Michigan. Then you find Duluth along the bank of Lake Superior. Then Flint, Detroit, Toledo, Cleveland, Buffalo, and Pittsburgh. These are the largest steel industry in the world. And the Pittsburgh, which is known as world capital of steel, Pittsburgh is the world capital of steel. And these steel plants, along with have sequential industry and have developed the automobile industry. Therefore, in USA, it has formed a unique industrial area known as Great Lakes Industrial Area, one of the richest, one of the largest industrial area in the world. Then you find New England industrial region covering the New England states. New England states of USA includes the Maine, New Hampshire, Vermont, Massachusetts, Rhode Island, Connecticut. These are six. Number one, Maine. Number two, New Hampshire. Number three, Vermont. Number four, Massachusetts. Number five, Rhode Island. Number six, Connecticut. Plus, number seven, New York. New York states. These seven states altogether form New England states, and this is the first industrial inertia of USA, of the North America continent. And these region very rich in iron ore and coal, so earlier, because over more than 150 years the industry has become very old. Now these region have highly developed in the world, and these region have shifted the nature of industries earlier, which were heavy industries, steel plants, automobiles, refineries, now have developed as a service sector industry, banking, the administration, education, and other type of service sector industries have been developed. South of the New England, this is from the Rust Belt of USA. Friends, this is the largest economy in the world. This is the region having maximum number of industries, maximum number of banks, maximum number of institutions. So right from New York, New Jersey, Philadelphia, Wilmington, Trenton, Baltimore, Delaware, Annapolis, Maryland, Washington DC, Alexandria, Richmond, Portsmouth, Norfolk, all these regions are a series of the sequential development of the industries. Friends, let me tell you that this region is not only having the benefits of the coastline, rather this coast is highly zigzag, having a large number of inlets, large number of creeks, coastal rivers, and these rivers now have been linked with the Great Lakes through the canals. And apart from mineral resources of the New England states, Appalachian region, I would like to add, there is another geographical asset for North America, for US and Canada, that look, this is Appalachian Mountain. The easternmost part of Appalachian Mountain, Cascade Range, and it's Piedmont. So, Piedmont form such a unique geographical condition that rivers draining from Appalachian all the way joining the Atlantic Ocean through the coast. And there are thousands and thousands of the rivers passing from Appalachian Mountains to the coastal areas along the east coast, and more than 1,000 rivers form waterfall on a straight line. Friends, this is known as fall line. This fall line, including of River Savannah, River Pidi, River Hudson, all together form thousands and thousands of water power plants. There are massive hydropower generation, and this hydropower generation along with the mineral resources that form the massive economic development of USA along the east coast. Then find the central part of USA drained by River Mississippi. And if you see the map of North America physical, River Mississippi, this is the longest as well as largest river of North America continent. Friends, thousands and thousands of tributaries coming from the Rocky Mountain ranges from the west, and hundreds of tributaries coming from the Appalachian Mountain, that is from the east. Friends, this is the reason that see Mississippi, its catchment area form very large dendritic pattern of drainage. Very large dendritic pattern of drainage. And again, look this yellow color and the green color. This is another fault line of Mississippi system and Rocky system. There are thousands of hydropower projects along the slope of Rocky Mountain, these rivers running from Rocky to Mississippi and from Appalachian to Mississippi. So, River Missouri, James, River Platte, River Niobrara, River Red, River Canadian, River Arkansas, these rivers coming from Rocky Mountain, while River Wabash, River Ohio, River Kentucky, River Cumberland, and River Tennessee. These are tributaries of Mississippi coming from the east. Friends, all these rivers have hydropower projects. You know, River Tennessee, once it was known as Sorrow of Mississippi. This is River Mississippi, and this is Mississippi state, political state of USA. So, when River Tennessee drained from Appalachian highlands, it flashed out at Mississippi and form flash flood almost every year. Friends, in the beginning of 20th century, there are more than 9 dams on Tennessee. So, the same river which was Sorrow of Mississippi, now it has become a model of development for the world, for the North America. So, in the plain area and through the Mississippi, right from this city of New Orleans, and you can see the map from New Orleans to the Chicago. This is New Orleans, the largest city in the delta of river Mississippi, and this is Chicago along the coast of Lake Michigan. Friends, all the way from New Orleans to Chicago, this is inland navigation, well developed inland navigation. Therefore, industries which are developed in the interior are linked with the globe through the inland navigation of transportation development. Central part of the Central Plains, highly developed in agro-based industries, and this is the area where the largest deposit of petroleum in USA. These states from Texas, Louisiana, Arkansas, these are the area, Arkansas and Kansas area, very rich in petroleum. Therefore, there are large number of chemical industries as well as petrochemical industries. Also, because of bauxite in Appalachian region and very cheap hydropower. So, this region have also aluminium industry, and along with aluminium industry, there are also the aircraft industry. So, the centers like Dallas, Houston, San Antonio, Austin, Arkansas, Kansas, these centers are highly developed in the aluminium plants as well as aircraft industries. Then, coming to the west, western part in the valley of Sacramento and San Joaquin. Friends, these two rivers dating from the north Sacramento, from the south San Joaquin, and they both drain in Pacific Ocean, and in the confluence of the Sacramento San Joaquin is the city of San Francisco. City of San Francisco, this is the city of Golden Gate. It is in fact, in true sense, it is a golden gate for economic prosperity of North America continent. So, San Francisco, San Jose, Sacramento, Oakland, Fresno, Bakersfield, these are the highly developed industrial cities in the world, and this is the Bay of San Francisco. Surrounding areas of the Bay of San Francisco, this is called Silicon Valley. Friends, this is Silicon, the world capital of software, computer software, world capital of computer software, Silicon Valley. Even you see how the people have developed the tourism development in the desert. This is the Nevada state, is a desert area, and within the desert, this is a Great Basin desert, and there is the world capital of tourism and world capital of casino, Las Vegas. Las Vegas, highly developed tourism, city of Phoenix in Arizona, and Denver in Colorado. Then Salt Lake City, Salt Lake City in Utah, and finally passing through the Columbia River, River Columbia, along with the tributaries, River Snake, there are big size of hydropower project, Hoover Dam. And because of very cheap hydropower, the city of Seattle and the Portland form very, very large aluminum industry and aircraft industry. Friends, in Canada, most of the, because northern part of Canada is very cold, so cities of in Canada lies along the east and southern part of Canada, like the beginning from the Halifax, Quebec, Montreal, Ottawa, Toronto, then coming to Winnipeg, Regina, Calgary, Edmonton, and Vancouver. Parallel to the boundary of USA, you find the most of the cities of Canada are located, because northern part of Canada extremely cold, become minus 60 degrees Celsius. Therefore, the settlement in the northern part of Canada is not possible. Extreme cold. You can see the density of population find under one. It's all blank. Under one, because of extreme cold, so population of Canada lives largely along the US border, along the Great Lakes, Great Plains, and the East Coast. Friends, there is a unique development of the industry in Canada. I'd like to tell you that in Canada, the most important resource are the forest resource, taiga forest. And they do commercial lumbering of the taiga forest. And very interesting, they cut down the forest, convert to the logs, and just simply they throw the logs in the lakes during summer season. Because during summer season, northern part of Canada, glacier melts down. By melting the glacier, the general slope of the land of Canada is, because of the lakes covering from north to south and from the mountains to the lakes. So lakes form the lowest part, so river draining from different direction to the lakes, carrying the ablation water. Therefore, Canadian people simply they clear the forest, form the logs, and just throw out in the lakes, and all the way is transported toward the southern part of Canada where the cities are. They manufacture as a paper. You know, Canada is the largest producer of newsprint in the world, and the largest economy of Canada, forest economy. The commercial felling of trees transported by lakes and rivers altogether known as lumbering. Therefore, Canada known as country of lumbering. Friends, lot of information I had given you, many more required. So whatever discussion we have done, because of lack of time, those points which you need some explanation, you can contact me through the EduSet lecture series, through the questions. Thank you very much.
On that note, I would like to thank sir for this very interesting discussion. I would like to thank you, dear friends, for watching our show. Stay tuned and keep watching. Thank you.